Okay, now we are at the point where I'm going to tell you about our final speaker of the day, and she is also going to do the closing. Her name is Dr. Dolores Gallagher Thompson, and she is a director of the Stanford Geriatric Education Center, a practicing psychologist, and a professor of research in the Department of Psychiatry and Behavioral Sciences at Stanford. She's been working for caregivers for about 20 years and has published a book and numerous papers in this area. She's well known for her work with ethnically diverse caregivers, particularly in designing intervention programs to reduce the stress and to promote well-being. In her time today, she's going to discuss several techniques for stress management that should be useful for both the family caregiver and professional caregivers. There will also be an opportunity to practice some of the skills and discuss what that experience is like. We hope you will learn some new things, and at the end of the day, we hope you will leave in a relaxed state of mind.
Thank you very much, Michelle. I appreciate that. Let's see. So we're going to have, can you just help me get started with the slides? I think it's not, am I doing the wrong one? No. So we're going to have some fun in this last hour and a half, okay, before we close. And that is, we're going to teach you some skills. Thank you. Thank you. We're going to teach you some skills that you as providers can use in your work settings and also teach the family caregivers about, the family caregivers that you work with. We're also going to ask you to observe the extent to which your tension levels change. And that's what these little thermometers have been about all day. And if you haven't done any recordings yet, please let me ask you to do a recording now, before and after this workshop. It doesn't matter if you haven't done the other ones earlier today. I mean, it does, but you know, it's too late to go back now. So please do it now. And remember that you're going to put the red bulb right on the tip of your middle finger. You're going to hold it there for about 20 seconds and see what happens to the number. And then please record it on the sheet in the right place, which is on the back of the page. And we will give you a number of resources for enhancing your skills that you can use, downloadable resources from the internet, lots of references to them. So our first skill, the first of three, is on mindful breathing and visualization. So this one is important, very important, because we breathe all the time, right? Does everybody here breathe regularly?
Yes.
Okay, good, thank you. All right, great. Now what we want you to do is to breathe more mindfully and breathe more deeply. And why is that? We want you to deliberately slow your rate of breathing. Take rhythmic breaths in and out. Breathe slowly and perhaps even count to yourself as you're breathing in and out so that you can establish the rhythmic pattern. And I would invite you all to do that right now as I'm talking so that you can get yourself in a relaxed frame of mind. Why is that important? Because if you're in a relaxed state, you're more able to problem solve. You're more able to deal with the stresses of caregiving in your environment. Now, breathing is supposed to be relatively easy to do this mindful breathing, but I've found that it's more challenging than you think, because most of us, we assume, of course, that our breathing is going to be automatic. We don't pay any attention to it. So what we're asking you to do is to call attention to it and to focus on it. And that is a very portable skill because you can use it anywhere. Now the visualization or guided imagery skill is another level of stress management skills because this involves more concentration and attention, more focus, and usually the ability to close your eyes. When you do a visualization, you're generally conjuring up a beautiful, relaxing image in your imagination or in your mind's eye. You can control it yourself, you can be guided by a practitioner, you can listen to a CD that are specially made for that. You can do an internal storytelling to yourself. So lots of different ways of doing visualization or guided imagery. The research base on both of these techniques is extensive. It's way too much to cover. But just to give you an example of one study that was done with the visualization and guided imagery with inpatient individuals with depression that listened for 10 days to 21-minute guided imagery CD. They did a combination of three things: muscle relaxation, imagining the scene in nature, and then creating the positive image. Well, let me just say a word about muscle relaxation. Many of you have heard about that, and perhaps you have done it yourself. We don't recommend that you start with that one, and I'm not going to spend time talking about that one, because a lot of older individuals cannot do progressive muscle relaxation. It is simply too much to contract and release the muscles in the various parts of the body. It becomes a frustrating experience rather than one that promotes relaxation. So the other two, the mindful breathing and the guided imagery, are much more likely to promote relaxation. So in the study that I mentioned, decreased depression, anxiety, and stress was found in the treatment group versus the control group. So guided imagery is a technique that works. And in general, why do relaxation techniques work? Because being relaxed is the opposite of being stressed on a physiological level. So when a person feels stressed, what happens to the body? It releases cortisol, which is a stress hormone. The heart rate goes up. The blood vessels constrict. The body gets into this fight or flight mode, and it gets ready to do something, which is not usually relaxing. So in contrast, when we do relaxation techniques and the body becomes relaxed, the heart rate and the breathing slow down. Measures of blood pressure show a decrease. There's a typo on this one. Oxygen consumption increases, and less of the stress hormone or cortisol is released into the body. And you'll see at the bottom of that slide, and also on one of your handouts, the URL for the complementary medicine website, where you can find out a lot more about this, the specifics, and you can go into much more detail. So what we're going to do now is we're going to do a practice session where we're going to ask you to please bear with me. I know that some of you may feel that you already know this and you don't need to practice it, and others of you might feel it's kind of irrelevant to your work because, you know, you're an administrator or something else and you don't really need to do this with caregivers or with your staff. But I would ask that you, for the sake of the conference and for the sake of your own expanded awareness of how helpful this can be, that you go with these exercises and just do them for a few minutes. So what we're going to do is ask you to turn to the person next to you and to go into dyads, okay? So pairs. So at a table, at each table, you don't have to move, except if there are three people at a table, then you might need to bring another person over, okay? I know it's not an ideal environment. It's noisy, it's crowded. I'd like everybody to listen for a moment. Could I have your attention again, please, for a moment? The instructions are here on the slide. What we want you to do is to teach the person next to you. So one of you is A, one of every pair is A, and the other one is B, okay? So identify who's A and who's B. Okay, everybody on the pair? Good. So far, so good. We've got an A and we've got a B. Okay. Now, A. So A is going to teach the breathing skill to B. A is going to teach the breathing skill to B. You can follow the wording here. You can look in your handout. We want you to yourself take a moment to center yourself, perhaps do a moment of deep breathing yourself, and then prepare to teach it to your partner. You will have 5 minutes, and then we will switch roles, Okay? Okay, everybody, let's do it. The A's have it. Comments? Questions? What you noticed? We have just a moment or two, because there's a lot we need to cover before 4 o'clock. So a moment or two of comments or questions. Yes, please. The comment was that the word expelling all the air might be too strong, and perhaps use the word let go, letting go. And that's certainly fine. You know, again, there's no one way to do this. This is just a suggested way to do it. The other thing, the other comment that someone made that I wanted to address was the notion that for a lot of women, breathing into the abdomen, you know, breathing into your belly and kind of feeling it expand is not comfortable, because we've heard for years, suck it up, right? Suck it in, you know, hold it in, flat tummy. You know, well, we're, in this case, okay, in this case, it makes a world of difference if you actually bring the air in deeply into the belly, let it expand. It's okay, all right, ladies, I'm giving you permission, it's okay. It's not going to ruin your figure, all right? So just that comment came up, I want to address that. Any other quick burning issue regarding this before we move on? Okay, then we're going to move on to visualization. I did notice that some of you closed your eyes during the breathing exercise. That's certainly an optional thing. Because remember I said breathing is something you can do anywhere, right? If you're driving your car, right, and you're stuck in traffic, please do not close your eyes and do the breathing exercise, all right? Please keep them open and do the exercise. Deep breathing in the car has saved me many strokes or something, because I get very frustrated. I'm a real type A, and it really bothers me when I have to sit in traffic. So I can tell you from personal experience that this stuff works as long as you keep your eyes open, okay?
Yeah.
All right, now, for the visualization, here you are encouraged to close your eyes, because here you're creating a scene in your imagination. So if each one of you would just take a moment to think of a positive place, a pleasant place, a place of beauty, relaxation, enjoyment that you've been to. Maybe Hawaii, you know, I don't know, maybe it's the mountain somewhere, Yosemite, or your backyard is a place of beauty and relaxation to you. Or you've gone to a museum recently, you've seen a beautiful painting, you've seen Monet's water lilies, and you say, oh, that's just extraordinary. Anything, it doesn't matter what it is, as long as it's a positive, relaxing, enjoyable image for you personally, okay? You don't have to tell anybody what it is. It's your image, your personal image. And what we want you to do is to elaborate on the image. That's what these instructions are all about, where you're trying to make the scene larger in your mind. By who's there with you? Are you there alone? What is it? What are the colors associated with it? Are there any sounds? Are there any sights? Any smells? If you're in a meadow, perhaps you smell the grass. You know, if you're at the ocean, the salty air. So you're engaging the senses as much as possible. And further, you can focus on any skin sensation. You might actually have a feeling of warmth, or if you like colder places, maybe you enjoy the snow, so you have that feeling of the cold, and you can actually almost feel it on your skin. So the more you elaborate and bring the sensations into the image, the more powerful it will be. And you can add a name to it. You can give it a name. You can attach a phrase to it that will help to bring it back to your mind. And you may choose to linger there a while. So this is not an exercise that you do when you're in a hurry. This is something you want to give yourself a few minutes to do because it needs to develop. So in this case, we're going to ask you to stay in your pairs. Now you've gotten to know each other a little bit, but one of you teach the visualization to the other. Okay, so it could be A or it could be B, it doesn't matter, you work it out. Whichever one of you feels like you've sort of got the idea, or maybe you've done it before, so you know. So the important thing is to try to teach this skill to the person, to your partner, okay? And you will have about 6 minutes for this exercise. 6 minutes and counting. So pair up with someone and teach them visualization. That came up. Did you notice, what are your thoughts or comments about this? I know it's artificial and it's a noisy room and, you know, it's difficult to do it in a short period of time, but does anyone feel that they learned anything from doing this exercise that they might be able to use clinically in your work? Anybody? The mind wanders, yes. This is actually a very common comment that people make when you're trying to do the breathing in particular. And that's why we call it mindful breathing or deeper breathing, because we ask you to focus on the breathing. This will engage your mind as well as your body. So it's a little different from meditation, because in meditation you're doing the similar breathing, but you're asked to empty your mind or have your mind free of thoughts. Here you're not asked to do that. You're asked to keep thinking, but think about your breathing. So you're directing the mental process to the breathing. Other comments? Other things that cross people's minds as they try to do this? Yes, over there. I'll try to hear you. The microphone is coming. Okay. Thank you. Yeah, I appreciate that. It's a big room. It takes a while to the microphone to get over there.
I feel like she's bringing me the Olympic torch. Anyway, I'm wondering in a clinical setting, it's never occurred to me before, that I'm wondering for people that have sensory deprivation due to aging issues or illness, chronic disease, if this might heighten their sensory perception during the visual imagery exercise.
Oh, that's a good question. I don't know of any research on that, to tell you the truth, but my guess is that it would. That it would be a useful thing and probably something that would relax them, would be perceived as helpful. I don't know of any research on it though. Mm-hmm. Oh, you didn't hear, okay. Yeah, the question was whether or not a person with sensory deprivation would benefit from an exercise like this, even if they weren't demented or weren't particularly stressed. And the answer was, I think so, but there's no research data on it that I know of on this particular thing. So, oh, there are some data? Okay, so. Uh-huh, okay, good. All right, other comments about when you tried to do this? Was it something that you feel you could use in your clinical setting? Did anyone think that perhaps they could employ this with their staff, with their caregivers, with family members, maybe even with yourself at times?
Hi there. Yeah, I have used it with my clients, and it works really well. Most of them have never meditated before, and they find that they can relax, really relax, and they're shocked by that, and they're really pleased. I noticed that before I did, I was at 88, and after I did the first one, I was at 98.
All right. Yay. Thank you very much for your comments. And I think it follows on Dr. McCurry's talk, you know, where she was talking about the importance of being able to use that ABC approach. Well, it seems to me that one reason why professional or paid caregivers and family caregivers don't use an approach like that is because they themselves are stressed in the moment. As we saw, you know, on some of the video clips, right, when the caregiver is stressed, it's much harder for them to do adaptive problem solving. It's harder for them to think about the resident first and to figure out how they could improve a situation. So by using simple breathing techniques, the staff can help themselves calm down and that will in turn enable them to deal with the situation better. So I think there's one last comment, okay, and then we'll move on.
Back when I was doing this on a regular basis with my patients, I found I developed a better sense of when I was relaxed, and that helped me tune into the patient's feelings a lot better. So when I feel myself tensing up, I realized the patient was actually getting upset, and that was one of the most valuable psychotherapy cues I had.
Did everyone hear her comment that when she was becoming tense, that she would figure that the client was also tense in that situation? And so by modulating her own stress level, Dr. Rosen's stress level, she would be able to calm the patient. So sometimes, even though you're not doing it directly with the person with dementia, it will have an indirect effect if you yourself are calm. And again, as Dr. McCurry mentioned, nonverbal behavior is so important in dementia. So nonverbally, if we're tense and stressed, that's going to rub off on the patient, so to speak, and tends to increase their stress. So, okay, let's move on then to the next skill, which is behavioral activation. So the first two, the mindful breathing and visualization, these are quick, they're easy to do, relatively easy to do, and again, in your handout, in the packet, and on the slides, on the bottom of some of the slides, you see that we've given you URLs for various websites where you can get more, you can download free handouts. There's also a detailed handout in your packet on the first two that you can use as a script. But moving on to this one, behavioral activation takes longer to accomplish. Generally speaking, we allow about a month for behavioral activation. So this is something for it to take effect. So this is something that you can do in an assisted living setting, in a nursing home setting. You can do on an outpatient basis with demented persons and their caregivers. Usually you involve both of them, but the caregiver is going to be the primary activator in this because they're usually more capable of understanding what you're trying to do. And there are several steps in the process of behavioral activation. So the first step is to really figure out what does the person enjoy. And this is a bit of an elaboration on some of the material that Dr. McCurry mentioned, because she talked about the pleasant event schedule that Linda Terry had developed. So this is a way to use the information from something like that. If you have access to that pleasant event schedule AD, here's a way to systematically use it. If you don't have that particular questionnaire, or you don't like using questionnaires, you don't have to. You can ask people, you know, what do they enjoy doing now that they're not doing? Or you can observe, in assisted living or nursing home facilities, you can observe what the person is doing that they seem to enjoy and not enjoy, and try to increase more of the former and less of the latter. But a lot of times, it also helps to try to figure out what the person used to enjoy, because what they used to enjoy doing is something that you might be able to reactivate in a different form currently. They might not be able to do it exactly the way they did, but in some other form. So the first goal is to identify activities that can be added in to the person's daily life. The second is to schedule those activities. So we don't wait for them to happen. We try to sort of make them happen. So we schedule them in and track them. So tracking means we observe whether or not they actually occurred. And then the third goal is to revise or modify our list based upon feedback, based upon what they seem to enjoy, because, you know, initially you may not be, you know, maybe far off the mark. But as you keep doing this, that's why it takes time, you get more and more accurate in terms of having a good solid list of things that are going to be enjoyable for that individual. And everybody is different on this. So we recommend that you try to develop a top 10 list. You try to get that many activities. Why? Because in a given day, the person may be able to be exposed to only two or three things on that list. They may not be able to do all of them. But if you have a top 10 list, you can choose, right? So you get at least a few in every day. You try to think about the barriers, and then you try to problem solve some of those barriers. And the mantra that I want you all to go away with is this one, okay? Some of you have heard this before, but I think it bears repeating. 4 pleasant events a day keeps the blues away. Okay, this is based on 10 years of research, a whole lot of people answering questionnaires and a lot of data collection. And it's really held up to be true that when not 2, not 3, those don't seem to be sufficient. It's 4 that seems to be the threshold. Once you get to that level on a daily basis, you're able to buffer yourself against the stress that's in our environment every day. And these activities don't need to be big things. I mentioned some simple things there, like having a favorite cup of tea or coffee, or looking at flowers, or the stars, or looking at clouds, perhaps walking around the neighborhood. They can be anything, reading something, anything at all that the person that works for that person. The challenge is to figure out what they are, right, and to get a list of about 10 of them, and to realize that they need to be consciously chosen, not haphazard, but go about that process that we've been talking about, and then deliberately done. So that's the scheduling, that's the monitoring, to be sure that they actually occur on that daily basis. We're not going to leave it up to chance. I think this one is kind of cute. The doctor said he needed more activity, so I hide his TV remote 3 times a week. We hope a little more than that is going to go on. And just a little bit of the scientific base here. If pleasant events are high, let's see, I'm not good at using pointers, so I'll just come over here and talk for a second. So mood is the squares, the triangles are the pleasant activities or pleasant events, and the diamond shape, or the bottom line on the graph, the unpleasant events or unpleasant activities. And the point of this is that over time, you see days of the week on the bottom, over time, even though unpleasant activities are happening in the person's life, which of course they are, and they certainly are happening in the demented person's life, and for many staff who work with demented people or professionals who do, there are certainly unpleasant moments. So, but by keeping the pleasant activities high, again, that was the triangle, by keeping them up around, in this case, it was minimum of 6, you know, it started low and went up, started around 6 and went up to around a 10. So it was really high. Why? Because those unpleasant activities were high, right? Unpleasant events were high. So the buffering effect means that even though these things are happening, having good number, solid number of pleasant activities every day kept the mood good, okay? Kept the mood up there, kept it positive. And that you will find in your experience to be true if you will practice this. And here's a diagram figure that you can use, that you can explain to your staff. You can use this with your family caregivers to explain the rationale. You're very welcome to copy it or to make some modification of it. It's very straightforward. It says, events or activities control mood to some extent. You can control activities to some extent. Therefore, you can control your mood. This leads to an increased sense of efficacy or mastery for reducing depression and improving quality of life. That's a real simple way of giving the rationale for this and helping people to get more engaged. So what we're going to do next is we're going to do the behavioral activation practice in pairs, okay? So now I would suggest that whoever did not do the visualization teaching takes a crack at the behavioral activation. Now for this one, we have a role play, okay? For this one, we want the individual who is Jane to play Jane and the other person to be the interventionist. Or it could be John, you know, if we can change the gender, that's fine, Jane or John. Okay, so Jane or John, a very depressed Caucasian 85-year-old person in the early stage of dementia, complains of having very little energy, trouble getting out of bed, taking care of basic needs, expresses sadness and is emotionally kind of labile. She moved into an assisted living recently, and she's saying that, you know, she's having trouble adapting. It's very small. She's in one room. She used to be in a house, then an apartment, so she's downsized. It's very hard for her. And she doesn't know how she'll maintain friendships. She has a few friends still alive that have been long-term friends, but this assisted living is not that close to where her apartment was, and so she's worried about maintaining these friendships, and she expresses this. So, will each of the pairs please decide who's going to be Jane or John, and who is going to be the interventionist? And then we're going to ask you to figure out how to help Jane using the behavioral activation approach, okay? And since time is short, we're going to ask you to try to follow the instructions on the slide. There are no typos on this one. Okay, follow the instructions on the slide. Try to come up with 5 activities for questioning of Jane. Try to discuss barriers and solutions to the barriers. Okay, and you have...
Maybe she's holding it close to her mouth.
7 minutes for this, okay? You have seven minutes for this. I want to please try to get through all of these steps, okay? And could the associates please be available? Larry and Nancy and Aaron and James and Tara. Participating. I saw a lot of participation out there, and I'm very glad to see that. I hope that at least for some of you this was new and is something that you will use in your programming. So I'd like to hear some ideas. How are you going to help Jane? What are some activities that you might have put on her list or developed on the list with her? Okay, what did you...
She's going to watch the tennis matches.
All right.
And she likes it.
She's going to watch tennis matches.
She needs to take a bath because she'll be jumping around.
Uh-huh. Ah, she needs... Okay.
And she likes to dance, so we're going to move her in to do it.
And she likes to dance, and she's, because she's moving a lot, it'll probably be easier to get her to take a bath. Maybe, you hope. Yeah, that sounds good. All right. What are some other positive activities that you think that you developed in your team for Jane or John, if it was a man? Okay, we have a comment.
Get her involved in pet therapy or something if an animal's available.
Ah, great idea. Pet therapy was mentioned. That could be a positive activity, and in some facilities it certainly is available now. And we saw the robot out there, the seal, little baby seal, right? I guess most of you saw that. That's another alternative if you don't want live pets or can't have them for one reason or another. That could definitely be a pleasant activity, pleasant event. Other ideas for Jane?
Our Jane likes coffee, and they would only give her coffee in the morning. But she had it 3 times a day at home, so we would arrange for the administration or the dietitian to give her coffee.
Uh-huh.
Find out what kind of day she really enjoyed it.
Yeah, okay, that was the coffee. If, I don't know if you all heard her, the suggestion was coffee, because the woman was used to having coffee and she enjoyed coffee, so even though normally it would only be given once a day, the idea of flexibility, and so they arranged it for her to have it more often. Okay, any other comments or suggestions or any other observations that any of you want to make about barriers or implementation of a program like this? Well, one thing that I noticed in walking around and listening to comments and things is that some people felt that they had been doing this for a while already, that it was already something that was active part of their programming in their facilities. So I would encourage those of you that maybe are not in settings where this is an active practice right now to talk with your colleagues about this, because it is really easy to implement. It is not that difficult, but it has some very powerful effects on people, on the residents and on the staff. So any last comment on barriers before we go into the next skill that I want to cover today? Did anyone come up with some barriers that seemed like insurmountable or like really, really tough to deal with that you want to share with the group that perhaps would be common?
I thought that coming up with 10 activities was a lot. I think you have to start where the client's at, and I felt with that when we were doing it like I was sort of pushing too hard. Mm-hmm. And so I would sort of see where the client's at, and for them maybe coming up with 4 activities would be, you know, something to start with.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe next time you met with that,
you could add to it.
Yeah, I just thought it, you have to kind of, depends on the client.
Yeah, that's a really good point. We set the bar high because of the notion that there's variability, you know, from day to day in what people can do, what they want to do, what programming is available for them. So if you start out with 10, you're likely to get 3 or 4 to actually happen. But that is a point well taken, that it might take you a couple of weeks to build up to that number. So it's it can be a gradual process. And I mentioned at the beginning that you really need to do this for a solid month. 4 weeks is really kind of a minimum for how long it takes for behavioral activation to really flow for the person and to really become effective. So once you get it started, you might actually find that it's something you want to continue indefinitely, because you'll see the benefit from it, and so will the individual. And so you might say, well, gee, this is working, let's continue it. So it doesn't necessarily have to have an end. Okay? All right, then let's move on to the third area or third skill that I want to talk about, which is the use of music. And we heard a little bit about that earlier. We saw on Tony's presentation, he showed you a bit of a preview of what I'm going to show you in a moment. And the idea, of course, with music is that it varies greatly what one person likes and another one doesn't like, just like the pleasant activities. Music can be a pleasant activity, obviously, or not, so you have to know the person. But this I want to call your attention to, because this is a practice guideline developed by a nursing colleague of ours and some other colleagues. Her name is Linda Gruner. She is associated with the Stanford Geriatric Education Center, and she did this when she was at the University of Iowa. So this gives you a very good step-by-step manual for using music therapy in assisted living or nursing home settings, and can be adapted for the home environment, obviously, but for the most part it was intended for assisted living or skilled nursing. There are questionnaires that help you to go through the program, assess staff knowledge, and so forth. And we mention it in our resource page, how you can actually get a copy. It's free, and it's very, very helpful. So here's an example of one study where music was used during the morning routine when the caregiver used music to help the person get ready. Music was played in the background, and the caregiver sang along with the patient, and sometimes actually sang to the patient. And what was found was that music helped greatly to facilitate this whole process. The positive emotions were increased, agitation was decreased, when the background music was used by itself, a sense of playfulness also was reported. So there was a positive side to it. It's not just decreasing agitation. But if the caregiver sang along, it seemed to increase the sense of intimacy, which is kind of interesting because we've been talking about that. We've been talking about trust and how to build it up between a caregiver and a client. And singing along might not be something that most of us would think of doing, but apparently it has a very profound effect for some. And different types of music therapy have been identified. It isn't necessarily just the receptive idea of listening to music, which has many different layers to it, but also it could be active. You know, play. Many people who play instruments still can play instruments to some degree or another, maybe not perfectly or as well, but they certainly can still create a rhythm or a sense that they get a sense of pleasure because they are accessing highly overlearned skills. And highly overlearned skills really resist degradation for a long time in the dementia process. So in the brain, there's even been research to show that music therapy affects the brain, it causes the two hemispheres to interact better with one another. And in fact, many areas of the brain that are not normally activated, and we like activation because that means a person is more with it cognitively. So when they listen to music, many more areas of the brain become activated because that's necessary to process the music. And it's even more so when it's active, when they're actively playing an instrument. So cognitive processing, sensory motor processing, and emotional processing all seem to be involved in music therapy. So music therapy, a good thing. And how do we use it? Well, now we're going to show you the YouTube clip that Tony prefaced. Some of you may have seen this, but it's certainly worth seeing again, I believe. So I think we're ready for it. It takes about 6.5 minutes, so relax and think about how you might use this in your setting.
I have one resident that really opened her eyes, she didn't respond. As much as I tried, I knew her for 2 years. No matter what I tried, massage wouldn't work, nothing worked. But when we got introduced to the iPods and the family told me the things that she liked, it was amazing once we put the iPod on her. She started shaking her feet. She started moving her head. Her son was just amazed. Okay, can we stop? Because now I'm getting all off. I'm seeing her all over again.
Seizures, and my mother couldn't handle him at home. Of course it affected me greatly because he was always, you know, fun-loving, singing, you know, every occasion he would come out with a song, no matter where he was. I remember as a child, he used to walk us down the street, me and my brother, and he would stop and just sing it in the rain. He would have us jumping and swinging around poles. He was, you know, he was good. He was always into music, you know, always loved singing, dancing.
His name is Henry Drea.
Uh-huh.
And looking more or less for a religious music for him. Because he enjoys music and he always quoted in the Bible. So I'd rather have that for him.
We first see Henry inert, vaguely depressed, unresponsive, and almost unalive.
Henry?
Yeah?
Henry?
Yes,
I found your music. You want your music now? Let's try your music, okay? And then you tell me if it's too loud or not.
Then he is given an iPod containing, we know, his favorite music. he starts to sing, to rock, and to move his arms, and he's being animated by the music.
And he used to always sit on the unit with his head like this. He didn't really talk to much people. And then when I introduced the music to him, this is his reaction ever since.
The philosopher Kant once called music the quickening art, and Henry is being quickened, he's being brought to life.
Yeah. I'm going to take a little for 1 second, okay? Just to ask you a few questions. Okay? I'm going to give it back to you.
Uh-huh.
Okay.
The effect of this doesn't stop, because when the headphones are taken off, Henry, normally mute, virtually unable to answer the simplest yes or no questions, is quite voluble.
Henry?
Yeah?
Do you like the iPod? Do you like the music you're hearing?
Yeah.
Tell me about your music.
Well, I don't have one, my man.
Do you like music?
Yeah, I'm crazy about music. Beautiful sound.
Did you play music when you did you like music when you were young?
Yes, I did the big dances and things.
What was your favorite music when you were young?
Well, Cab Calloway was my number one band guy, I like. That is the one that I did, the one that I did, the one that I did.
What's your favorite Cab Calloway song?
I'll be my Christmas. You can come by me with plenty of snow. Mistletoe, present that brand new tree. Ow!
He sings his restored to himself. He has remembered who he is, and he's reacquired his identity for a while through the power of music. What does music do to you?
It gives me a feeling of love. Romance. Because right now the world needs to come into a music setting. You know how beautiful music can. Beautiful, I love it. And I feel a belly of love, dream. Lord King to me, give me hope, I'm not a man. So, he gave me this sound. Well, he said, I meet you. And he said, Rosalie, 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 Rosalie,
with this beautiful new technology, you can have all the music, which is significant for you, in something as big as a matchbox or whatever. And I think this may be very, very important in helping to animate, organize, and bring a sense of identity back to people who are out of it otherwise. Music will bring them back into it, into their own personhood, their own memories, their own autobiographies.
I think we would all agree that's very moving, a very moving clip, and it's also very effective. I mean, did you notice the change in this gentleman? We saw what he was like before and after, a very dramatic and very meaningful change. So, what I'd like you to all think about is how you could incorporate music, how you might use music therapy or music, approaching music, incorporating it, involving the client in figuring out what kind of music. How would you do this in your setting? Can you imagine applying it either outpatient, I work with caregivers in an outpatient setting, so that's a different thing than assisted living or a nursing home. Maybe some of you work with caregivers in a different capacity. Can you think of how you might apply what you just saw here, how you might go about using music therapy? Anybody? I know that's a big question. Okay, Dr. Rose.
I gave you her name, but we had someone demonstrating a music app for dementia patients. And Marguerite, are you still here? Anyway, she was demonstrating it in the lobby.
Marguerite Manto Rao, I believe is the name, MANTEAU-RAO. But I guess, I suppose if you Googled music for Alzheimer's or something, you probably would find her. So a music app for the iPhone, something like that, so it makes it even easier. But I think it's important to remember that the music has to be personalized. You know, it really does. You have to get the playlist right. I don't know how long it took Dr. Oliver Sacks or how long it took the staff in the nursing home to figure out. You know, I suspect that the daughter provided some useful information as to the kind of music that he used to enjoy. And so that was no doubt helpful. But you got to get the playlist right. And yes, another comment on the kind of in the right hand side of the room, my left. The lady who was in the striped shirt there?
Yeah. Well, she wanted to know how to get that YouTube too, clip.
How to get the YouTube clip? Oh. It's on the, it's in your slide set. It should be on the bottom of the slide.
It's also, if you go to the website and you can Google music and memory, that the whole website is about playlists and it's an organization. You can get certified. It gives you tips and pointers on how to build playlists. And the clip is there because it's a documentary. Or you can just Google it on YouTube, music and memory.
Thank you. Very helpful. Hello.
Thank you very much. I was a volunteer at Rosner House. Rosner House is here today. And I learned so much from my friends at Rosner House with music that I carried it over where I could in my practice. And there was a client that I had that actually went to Rosner House who had dementia, Lewy bodies. And she would become very, very agitated when you take her to the doctor and you're waiting for that doctor to come into the office. And she would get so agitated, she would, but what do I do? She'd reach over and she'd pinch you and it would, you know, you could watch out, it was really fast. And so, turned out we knew she was from Hollywood. So, I just thought you have to find out, you have to dig. And it turned out she could never generate anything, but if I would start it, she would sing, she'd finish it off for me. So you know, it had to be you, it had to be you. My job was to figure out songs of that period and then just see which ones, and she pretty much knew all of them during that time. Happy as a clam, the nurse would come in smiling, everyone was happy.
Wow, thank you for sharing that. A very real life application of the music therapy.
Mm-hmm. Yes, another comment over here.
Can you just wait for the mic to come because I don't think we can hear you otherwise. And meanwhile, all of us, you can be reading those tips there.
Uh-huh. Yes, one of the really powerful learnings that I was participating in was one of Keepa Snow's clips that she had where they were trying to get someone to walk and they started just singing and walking with the person and they would walk and they were doing Daisy Daisy and then the caregiver decided to sing Amazing Grace and the person let go, put their head down and stopped. And it turned out that the caregiver had heard Amazing Grace in a positive context at, you know, gatherings, and the other person had heard it at funerals. So that is an indicator of how specific the individual person is and in what context you're using music.
Thank you for that comment. That's a very good point, and we do need to keep that in mind, right? So what you like and what's good for you and relaxes you may have the opposite effect on me. And we can sure see that with our kids, right? Our teenagers or... Okay, so any other comments on music therapy before we go on?
I can speak.
Oh, yes. She has an app, okay? Go ahead.
Well, thank you for the privilege of sharing a little bit about this
new music app I've been developing for caregivers like you. It's an app that's meant to foster positive engagement between caregivers and the person in their care using music. And it's an app for the iPad, and it starts by helping people find familiar music that resonates with a person, and then it guides them to look at the person's natural responses to the music. Let's say if a person starts singing, then it will provide you lyrics that you can both follow. If a person starts moving, it provides you with tips on how to enhance the exercising potential with the music. If a person starts reminiscing, it will give you tips, and it will also help you find photos on the web or in the iPad library that speak to the person's memories for that particular music, and then stores them in an album that you can always go back to every time the person listens to that particular music.
Great.
It also helps with music trivia and suggests questions to ask based on information that's provided. And then it also stores videos that you can take of a person engaged, positively engaged in all these activities. And then you can play back the videos, and the person can watch themselves in this happy moments. You can also share with family members those videos and on Facebook. And finally, you can track the engagement from session to session in terms of time and how the person spends their activities, the different activities.
Great, thank you very much.
Thank you. Thanks for this opportunity to share.
Thank you.
So the name of the app is called Karanga for Care and Engage, and it's right now in development.
Will you repeat that, please?
Karanga, Karenga. For Care and Engage. Oh, and it's okay. Gonna be, right now it's in beta testing, so I'm looking for people who are interested in testing the app. And it should be released in the Apple Store in about 2 months.
Great, thank you very much.
Thank you for this opportunity.
All right. You're welcome. So in the closing moments that we have, I'd like to call your attention to the fact that there are many other techniques for stress management, right? So maybe one of your favorite ones is now on the list. We just focused on a few that were easy to do in a large group and that would be easy for you to implement in your settings, or easier than most of these. You heard about exercise. There are multitudinous studies on the value of exercise for persons with dementia and for their caregivers. Meditation improves stress, mood, and so forth. Meditation is a skill that takes longer to learn than any of the ones that we've talked about so far. Yoga is another one that is more physically taxing. There are many older individuals that cannot really do yoga. There are adaptive forms of yoga meant for people who have physical disabilities in addition, or suffer from pain, a lot of pain and so forth. There's adaptive yoga. But yoga takes quite a while to master and to begin to get the benefits. Similarly with Tai Chi, Qigong are two forms of movement that have been utilized very, very well with many older adults, but the literature on their use with persons with dementia is very sparse. So exercise, mentioned on the previous slide, exercise and meditation. Exercise, of all of these that I'm mentioning here at the end, exercise is the one that has the most data behind it for its usefulness with persons with dementia and their caregivers. The others have very few empirical studies, but they certainly seem promising. So five final recommendations. And this is for all of us, okay? not just the people we work with, but final recommendations for us to help keep us balanced, right? And to help keep us doing the great jobs that we're all doing in the field. The first is learn to express gratitude.
You know, there are books out about this, about the psychological value and the physiological value of having a moment every day, particularly when you first wake up in the morning, to start the day with an attitude, time out. Think about the things in your life that you're grateful for. Fostering optimism. So thinking about the future as what the good things are that are ahead, not necessarily focusing on the negatives. Practicing kindness. For a while, that bumper sticker was really popular, right, about random acts of kindness. You know, I'm sure we all do it, but if we do it more mindfully, I think we will find that we're managing our own stress better. Recapping the joys of life, sharing them with others. When you think about the rise of the social media, you know, Facebook and Twitter, what's it all about? You know, it's about sharing the good things that happen and learning about the good things that happen to other people and sharing in their experiences. And then finally, learning to forgive. This is really a big one. This is a big one for caregivers, particularly for caregivers who might have had conflicted relationships with the person that they're caring for, which, you know, tend to be common, unfortunately, that there might be a history of significant stress there in the relationship, which makes the caregiving that much more challenging. So learning to forgive, letting go of anger, past hurts and things like that, moving on. These are things that can help all of us manage our stress better. This is one of the resource slides that I mentioned. We have on the Stanford Geriatric Education website, we have access to videos that will train you more in much more depth on how to do behavioral activation. So if any of you were intrigued by that and thought that perhaps that's something that you would like to get more skilled at doing, please go to our website and we'll be happy to work that out with you. These are some references for some of the other techniques. And lastly, we want to just thank you for your attention today. And